missing, and you'll get something from God in this house tonight. Everybody say, God bless your heart. Thank you, Brother Hamilton. Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. Why don't we clap our hands to the Lord again today? Well, come on, lift up your voice with the hand clap and let's give the Lord praise. Oh, we love you, Jesus. Come on, anybody got the victory tonight? Anybody full of the Holy Ghost tonight? Lord, we love you, Jesus. Praise God. Amen. It's certainly good to be Camp Bond tonight. And this is not my first time around your fellowship, but it is my first time to camp. And I want to say what a privilege it is to be invited to come. And not only get to attend some of this, but to get to preach it. And this is a great honor tonight. And I give honor to all of the ministry brethren that helped put this on. Aren't you thankful for good men of God, your pastors, your leadership? Why don't we give them a hand? Saved without a preacher, can you? Amen. Anybody here thankful for your man of God? We want to give my apologies for my absence from last night. I was ministering to the Lord about 2 hours from here for a friend that had asked me to preach for him last night and drove in today. So forgive me for not being here. And tomorrow I have a prior engagement that I have to leave for. And I do apologize for that. That is not my custom. So don't think I'm just trying to bug out on y'all or anything. But I'm very glad to be here. And I appreciate all of you. Glad to see my friend Brother Gary Jones here tonight. Amen. He's my assistant pastor around our place. He comes and takes care of our church for us from time to time when we have to be gone. And our church loves the Johns. Amen. A great, great family. And I'm so pleased to see this brother coming here tonight. Love this family very much. All of the good minister brethren that testified tonight, we can leave right now and say we've heard preaching. Amen. 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 I want to try to give you tonight what I feel in my heart. I don't feel like I am a camp meeting, family camp, whatever this is, preacher tonight. I have tried to mind what I feel in my spirit tonight, and I have prayed and asked for the Lord to give me direction. As a preacher, it's not always a matter of having things to preach, that money to preach, but having the right thing to preach. And I'm going to tell you tonight, I have wrestled in my spirit for this service, but I feel like God sent me here for somebody tonight. Somebody here tonight that's in the midst of a struggle. Somebody tonight that's in the midst of a trial. I feel like God has sent me here for you tonight. And if it's not but just one person tonight, you're looking at a home missionary tonight that'll go for one person. Amen. But if it's just one person tonight, that your eternity can be changed, that your your outlook on your circumstance can be fixed tonight, we will have succeeded. Amen. I wonder if we can lift our hands right now before we go to the word of the Lord. Come on, why don't you reach over one of your hands, put it on your neighbor. Let's pray. Come on, I feel like the Holy Ghost is going to minister tonight. Oh God, we are such a needy people tonight. We are so in need of your presence, so in need of your help. Dear God, I pray that you would help me to deliver my soul. Help me, God, to say what you've given me tonight. Lord, let your will be done in this place tonight. God, let the Holy Ghost confirm the word tonight. Bind every foul and unclean spirit. Let the Holy Ghost minister tonight. Let there be deliverance. Let there be strength. Let there be help tonight. Let somebody see, Lord, where they're going in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. If you have your Bible, let's go to 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel chapter number 5. While you're turning there, I also want to say that I regret that my wife and children are not with me. Last week was spring break, and we didn't go on vacation, but we went to church. Imagine that. Amen. And from not this past Sunday, but the Sunday before, from that Sunday till now, I have been in over 12 church services. Amen. So I've been in a little bit of church the last few nights, and I'm glad to be here tonight. Praise the Lord. But my wife and children were not able to come with spring break being over. My wife is their teacher, and they have to get back to school. And so anyone that homeschools understands all of that. And I appreciate your understanding of their absence. But I love my wife and my two boys. Thankful for them tonight. I give them honor. 2 Samuel chapter number 5 and verse number 17. But when the Philistines heard that they had anointed David king over Israel, all the Philistines came up to seek David, and David heard of it and went down to the hall. Bible said that when they heard David was anointed king, all the Philistines came out to seek David. And they weren't coming to shake hands and congratulate him. They was coming to do him in. I want to preach tonight by the help of the Lord simply this: the blessing of struggle. The blessing of struggle. Amen. Father, I thank you again tonight. Pray that you would bless your word to every hearer in this house tonight. God will be careful to give you the praise for what is done. Clap your hands to the Lord tonight. Lift up your voice and praise God. Come on, give the Lord a shout of victory right now. Oh, hallelujah. Well, I feel the Holy Ghost here tonight. I believe God's going to help us before we go. We learn about him early on in Sunday school. We learn about his encounter with Goliath. We learn about David early on. And I think that one of the reasons David catches our attention is because as human beings we can see ourselves somewhere in that man's life as we get to read about it. One thing is that he was very familiar with struggle. Long before we read of David being anointed king, we read of him being the shepherd boy for his father Jesse. David was tending his father's sheep when the prophet Samuel came to his daddy's house. And when his own dad didn't even believe that he was worthy to be paraded before the prophet Samuel as a possibility for the anointing of king, God knew where David was at. God knew what David was doing. And when all of the brethren had been paraded before the prophet Samuel, being sensitive to God, said, "Is there not another?" He knew he didn't miss it. And he said, "Yep, there is one more." And he's out there tending to the sheep. But I don't think he would be. Go get him. Go get him. And they go and they fetch David. And I can see the brothers, maybe Eliab. He went. Said, "Hey, David, there's somebody at the house wants to see you. Probably ain't going to mean nothing, but they want to see you." And David very quickly gives his brother the shepherd's staff because he's not going to leave those sheep unattended. He says, "Well, I'll go, but you're going to have to stay here because these are daddy's sheep. And I've been fighting lions and I've been fighting bears to defend these sheep. I've been out here in the struggle. You've been down at the house, but I've been in the struggle. And I've got these sheep at stake. I need you to stay here while I go see what daddy needs." He goes to the house, and as soon as the prophet Samuel lays eyes on him, God speaks to him and says, "That's him." Oh, thank you, Lord. And the prophet takes that ram's horn. He uncorks that cork out of that bottle. And he tells David to kneel. And he anoints him with that anointing oil. Oh, thank you, Lord. That was a moment that David will never forget. That was a moment that David would always remember, as that oil flowed down off of the locks of his hair, flowed down his cheeks, down his chest and garments, down his legs, as that prophet poured that out and declared him to be the next king over God's people. Now, David did not go back to the throne right away, or didn't go to the throne when that happened. David went back to the sheep. David went back to the struggle. David went back to doing what he always done. But the Bible tells us that from that moment on, the Spirit of the Lord rested upon David. Thank you, Jesus. And David goes back to tend to his father Jesse's sheep. And as time progresses, we don't really know how much time lapses. And that's one of the things we miss in Scripture sometimes. We read it very hastily, very quickly. But there's days and weeks that lapse sometimes between the verses. We don't know how long David went back to tending those sheep and went back to fighting the bears and the lions. We don't know how much time lapsed. But we do know this: God's hand was upon him, and God went with him back to the struggle. Now, David continues to do all of this and tend to those sheep. It's thought that he could have been anywhere from 19 to 20 years old, maybe even as old as 25, when the prophet anointed him to be king. And the little catch to all of that is there's still an existing king in power by the name of Saul. But he's got in trouble with God because he don't know how to listen to a preacher. And God has withdrawn himself from him. And Saul is now tormented with an evil spirit. And Saul says, "I need somebody to come and play some anointed music in my house." And somebody speaks up and says, "Well, I know just the man. There's a man that little community where there's a son named David, and he's a harpist. He's quite the musician. Saul don't even know what's happened to this point. Saul's not even privy to the fact that he's in the process of being replaced by God, and don't even realize it, but God is allowing him to call for David. He says, send for him, bring him. Let him play. Saul immediately develops a love for the man as the spirits that torment him are driven from him, because anointed music drives away the evil spirits. And he eventually makes David his armor bearer. In the process of time, it's interesting to me as I looked at this story, David goes back to the shepherd's field. He's the armor bearer of King Saul. But yet he still takes time to go back to the shepherd's field. He goes back to that place of his original beginning and his original struggle. And he goes back to tend to daddy's sheep, even though he's the armor bearer. And he's killing lions and he's killing bears. And he don't realize it. He thinks he's just going through a routine of tending to business, taking care of daddy's sheep. But God's preparing him through that struggle for the next struggle. Some of us here tonight in this house are enduring things that we don't understand. But I want to tell you tonight, before you can face the lion, you got to deal with the bear. And once you deal with the bear, you can now deal with the lion. But you're not going to be ready for Goliath until you can learn to deal with the bears and the lions in your life. You may be upset tonight in your spirit that there's a struggle in your life, but I've come to preach to you that God's got purpose in what you are going through and in what you are dealing with. He's getting you ready for something greater. The Philistines are set in array against Israel. Word gets back to David. He's the armor bearer. Word gets to him. They're drawing up battle lines. There's fixing to be warfare. And David gets wind of all of this. Jesse says, go down and see how the battle's going. You know, I read that and I can tell his daddy didn't have a lick of confidence in him. He is the armor bearer of King Saul. And he's talking to him like he's an 8-year-old kid. Why don't you go see how the battle's fair? Go down there and check it out for me. Take a little bread, take a little cheese down there, and see how everything's going. David never gets crossed up. David keeps a good spirit. I'll tell you what, struggle will do one of two things to you. It'll either make you bitter or it'll make you better. Oh, hallelujah. It'll make you have a good spirit or it'll make you have a nasty spirit. I believe tonight God's wanting to try to help somebody in this room to let struggle have a positive effect on you. It's time for you to get rid of the vitriol and poison of your circumstance and realize that God's got a purpose for your life and God's got something in mind for you. Exactly what his dad says to do, and when he gets there, I'm not going to belabor the point, but he hears the cursing of that giant. We know how the story goes. Is there not a cause? He goes out, collects the 5 smooth stones, he goes out there and he whips Goliath, takes down the champion of the Philistines. A great victory was wrought that day. Great, great things were accomplished that day. And from this point, David begins to be elevated. David begins to dwell with a little more frequency around the palace. And finally, there comes a time where Saul begins to put the puzzle pieces together. And he says, you're not going to get my crown. And he purposes in his heart to destroy David, the one that he used to love. Let me just interject
here tonight, and I felt this in preparation for this service. The struggle that went on inside his family, you could tell there was tension in that home between those brothers and David. You can tell it when he showed up on the battlefield that day and they called him a naughty boy. Amen. You can tell there is vitriol there. There's jealousy at work there as this man progresses. But David understands, even though they may throw their darts at me, I've still got the anointing of God upon my life. You gotta remember, in the midst of your struggle, whether it's through people or whether it's through circumstance, you gotta remember that God's got his hand on you. God's not gonna let it destroy you. God's gonna let it develop you. Don't you let the struggle be your destruction tonight. Story rolls on. Saul dies. And David ascends the throne at 30. 30 years of age, he begins his reign. And the Bible tells us that he was anointed again, but this time by the people. The people now anoint him. He's already anointed by God, but now the people anoint him to be their king at Hebron. And one of the first things that David does is David sets his sights upon the city of Jerusalem. Jerusalem at this point is called Jebus. It is a Jebusite stronghold. And David says, I want to set up my headquarters there. The Jebusites say, not on your life, Bubba. You're not going to take this from us. And David, there's one thing about somebody that's been through a few things. They don't take no for an answer very easily. They don't just lay down and take it very easily. Amen. When the adversary says you can't make it, if you've been through a few hard knocks, you rise up in the Holy Ghost and say, yes, I can. David goes and he does exactly what it says he did. And he takes Jerusalem. He sets it up as headquarters. Makes Jerusalem the capital of the nation of Israel. Up to that point, Hebron had been the order of operation. And David establishes all of this. That's why it's called to this day the city of David. It's 3,000 years later, and they're still fussing over Jerusalem. I want to tell you something. God set that thing up like that. God established that through a man who understood, I might be going through a struggle, but I know what God's told me to do, and I'm going to set that place up, and the tabernacle's going to be there. The temple of God's going to be there. The name of God will be established in that place. And the devil don't like what Jerusalem symbolizes to this day, because it is evidence that a man can triumph in the midst of struggle and come out on top by the power of God. Amen. I'm going to tell you tonight, if you can make it through your struggle, if you can make it through your hardship, there's a blessing on the other side. There's miracles on the other side. There's things that can be established in your family for years to come if you'll overcome your struggle. Come on, clap your hands to the Lord. Struggle. Right. adversity and the struggle tonight. I hope tonight that before this service is over with, whatever it is that you're dealing with tonight, whatever it is that you're facing tonight, and it looks so insurmountable that you will look at it and realize it might be hard, it might be challenging, but there's a blessing. We can face anything if God goes with us. The Bible said David grew great and the Lord God of hosts was with him. Amen. That's the thing you got to understand tonight. Whatever struggle you come up upon, if God's on your side, if God is with you, it doesn't matter who's against you. It doesn't matter what they're saying. Well, I feel good in the Holy Ghost right now. I said, I feel good in the Holy Ghost right now. Somebody needs to understand there's a blessing. Pushing forward. The Bible tells us there's a king by the name of Hiram. Of Tyre. Best I can tell, Hiram is not Israel. He's a heathen. But he gets wind. It's amazing. No social media. Snail mail was really snail mail back then. Pigeon mail, yeah. Courier mail. But he got wind that there's a new king in Israel.
Yeah.
And he's doing something different.
Yeah.
He's learned how to listen to a preacher.
Uh-huh.
He's learned how to submit himself to the things of God.
Yeah.
He's learned how to yield himself to the process of God. And God's working through him. He's done one Jerusalem. He's done seen great things happen. And all high. A wise man. I want to be friends with that man. And he sent cedars, sent down big logs, and gifted all of that to David in good graces, saying, I want to befriend you because I see the hand of God in your life. There's some of you precious young people tonight that you face struggles that some of us adults didn't have to face. I'm not too far removed from where you're at. I ain't but 37 tonight. I know tonight that you are dealing with things. You're dealing with struggles tonight, some of you, that maybe nobody else even knows about. And I'm going to tell you, if you can overcome that, if you can overcome that, there's going to be people that don't even believe this message that's going to look at you and say, I want what you've got. I want to be your friend. I want to be close to you because I see the hand of the Lord upon your life. We've got some young people in our church right now. Amen. Over, I guess, 90% of my congregation is under the age of 25. Don't tell me young people don't want the Holy Ghost. Amen. Most of our church is young families. We're not a big church, but understands that. Amen. We're a small congregation. Amen. But God has given us some young families. Amen. And I'm watching some of those young people as they're getting a hold of this. They've got young children, just babies, just getting started. Some of them don't go up or down hardly when it comes to living for God. But they're getting a hold of something. And their friends are watching them change. Their friends are seeing them change the way they dress, act, and talk. And they're starting to ask questions. Your struggle tonight just might be the salvation of that sinner friend. It just might be the salvation of your lost mom and daddy. People started noticing. David perceived that the Lord had established him king over Israel. And that he had exalted his kingdom for his people Israel's sake.
Well, it's not a grandiose thought.
He's just now realizing God is helping me to do all of these things.
It wasn't an oversight, but David wasn't a presumptuous man. And he begins to understand God's doing all of this. God is establishing all of this. But I like what it said at the end of that passage. He said it's for the people of God's sake. It's for Israel's sake. David understood that my struggles and my battles and my fights, it's got something to do with me, but there's a broader picture at stake. You could understand that tonight, brother, that there's more at stake than just your walk with God. But there's other people that are watching. There are other people that need you to be strong in the midst of your struggle. And the adversary. Start trying to pull you back down. And the Bible tells us that right in the midst of some of these struggles and battles and fights, and there's hills to climb and valleys to go into and mountaintop experiences. It's not all a struggle, but yet a great portion of this man's life is struggle. And all, the Bible said, all the Philistines, they get wind of what God is doing. They get wind of how God is working. And all of a sudden, they get it in their mind. We're going to take this guy out while he's early on. We're going to kill this man. We're going to destroy this man. And they all rise up with one accord to take David out. You feel like your back is against the wall. You don't know what to do. You don't know where to turn. Amen. But let me challenge you tonight in the Holy Ghost. Do what David did. David said, I'm not going to just hastily go out and fight this battle, but I'm going to go have a prayer meeting. You done heard a little bit about that tonight. But you'll never go wrong praying.
Won't tell you, it's always a struggle.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
are you going through?
Right.
Hallelujah. And there is reprieve. We understand that tonight. There is reprieve. But he said, brother, it was always a struggle. You know, it'd been one thing if that man had $1 million in the bank sitting in the cathedral. But I was talking to a man that had been in a storefront between a washateria and another church. And I preached in that washateria church, if I can call it that, that storefront. I preached in that church. And I can remember trying to have church over the top of the other church that was over there beating and banging and carrying on. Because they were some kind of Pentecostal too. Hallelujah. There's a Hispanic church. And they had that thing wrapped up. But that man understood what struggle was. That man understood what hardship was. That man knew what he was talking about. And I didn't want to hear that. But I have found out that it's the truth. We live in a day and age where people want it quick. People want it fast. People want instant churches, instant revival. Let me just tell everybody here tonight, there is no such thing as instant church or instant revival. You might have instant bricks and oatmeal, but there ain't no instant church. If you're going to have church, you're going to have to contend for church. If you're going to have a church of any size, you're going to have to fight for it. You're going to have to pray. You're going to have to fast. You're going to have to work for it. You ought to make up your mind tonight. When I go back home, I'm going to be the best saint I can be. I'm going to get to tell my pastor. We're going to have revival. That's how long it takes. We're going to have revival. Always a struggle, he said. And that man, God blessed them, helped them after 10 years in that storefront. Some folks want to give up after a year worth of that. But after 10 years in that storefront, oh, thank you, Lord. The piece of property that the old original church in that town started on, that it went away. They were able to get that piece of property given to them. And they built a beautiful building on that piece of property. But they had to go through some struggles to get there. And they still haven't struggled. It doesn't end just because you get to a certain point. That's where I want to preach to us tonight. Is we get to these victories, these high points, these high water marks, and we feel like we've arrived and we should never have to go through another struggle. But I want to tell you, you can't continue to grow. Well, I feel that coming back to me tonight. But you can't keep growing if you don't keep struggling. You can't keep developing if you don't keep fighting and keep struggling. Perpetual difficulty all your life. There will be times of reprieve, but then you're going to get back in another struggle. And what you've got to learn is, Lord, what you brought me through up to this point was getting me ready for right now. Was getting me ready for the next devil, the next battle. And God takes us from glory to glory, from faith to faith. But with every bit of that, you're going to fight hell. You're going to fight the devil. You're going to fight principality. I'm looking at some people tonight that you got the potential to be a powerhouse in your church. What I understand of hydroelectric plants is in order for the power to be developed, there's millions of gallons of water that has to turn the turbine. And it's the stress and the pressure that's applied to that produces the electricity. You may not feel like you're very much tonight. You may not feel like you can accomplish much tonight. But if you can let the struggle have a positive influence and impact in your life, you
told her what the Lord told me. text her from the platform. Forgive me for doing that. But I'm telling you, I was trying to make sure I heard from God. I was wondering maybe if God spoke to her or something. They heard different now. Oh, hallelujah. And so this is what I feel. She said, do it.
Glory, glory.
Put it in the offering. Service, tremendous service, tremendous move of God. At the end of that service, the pastor of that church had asked for some ministers among whom I was numbered. They were facing building situations. There was about 7 or 8 of us there. He called us up on the platform. He said, I want these brothers to pray for one another. Pray for their needs and pray for each other. Not pray for their personal need, but pray for their brother's need. And he said, I want this church to pray for them. And while you pray for them and they pray for one another, God's going to meet your need. Anyway, the place blew up. Holy Ghost moved. I gave that offering. I didn't know what God was going to do. I was in the struggle, okay? I didn't know how God was going to do it. David didn't know what God was going to do with the Philistines. David didn't know how God was going to do it all. I didn't know how God was going to work it out. But at the end of that service, a minister out of that group come to me. And he said, when you find out, I'm paraphrasing, shortening this down just a little bit for the sake of time. But he said, when you find out how much you're going to pay a month for that, he said, I'm going to tell you what the Lord told me to do while we were praying. I'm going to take money out of our building fund. We're facing a building situation, needing to build something, needing to do something, and can't get anything done. He said, but I'm going to take money out of our building fund, and I'm going to pay your first year's rent in that building. Well, hallelujah. I'm telling you, I didn't know how God was going to do that, but God already had a plan. But he had to put me in a struggle to get me there. You might be in a struggle tonight, but you ain't never going to tell. God. Amen. The Lord's helped them. Amen. But it took a struggle. It took hardship. It took difficulty. It took problems to get that man to where God needed him to be, to get me where I needed to be. And I'm telling somebody here tonight, in the midst of a struggle, it may not be pretty right now, but God's got a blessing for you. God's got a miracle for you. You might be sick in your body, but that's all right. God's a miracle worker. God's a healer. Whatever you're going through, that's a blessing. Philistines come out of the woodworks. David don't know what he's going to do. He prays. God says, you're going to doubtless overcome. God's going to deliver them into thine hand. I will doubtless deliver them into your hand, David. David holds on to his word from the Lord. Oh, my God. Somebody here tonight needs to hold on to the word of the Lord in your life. I'm just about finished, but somebody here needs to get a hold of this and don't let it fall on the ground and you walk out of here saying, well, that was okay. I'm telling you, grab a hold of this and take it home with you. You're in the midst of the struggle, but a blessing's about to break forth. I said a blessing's about to break forth. Spread themselves in the valley of Rephaim. Yeah. I'll tell you, you go through one victory, don't lay down. Keep your sword in your hand. Keep your shield in the other hand. We ain't got time to lay any of that down until we hear the Lord say, well done. Stay in a position and stay in the fight. Stay in a posture and understand there's another battle coming. But David knows that he's going to have the help of the Lord again. Dealing with the same enemy. Dealing with the same hardship. Sometimes we feel like that we can use the same methodology that we used on the last deal. And it'll work out the same way on the next deal. But most of the time it's not that way. God's taking you to another level. That's what I'm trying to get across to us here tonight. God's got a plan in mind. God's got another level that he's wanting to take us to. But we got to go through this struggle. We got to go through this hardship. Stand with me tonight. We got to seek the direction of the Lord in every battle we face. Every struggle we go through, instead of going to pieces, we need to find us a prayer room and talk to God. Because if I read the Bible right, it says all things work together for good to them who love God, who are called according to his purpose. That lets me know that it does not matter what it is. God's going to work that thing for my good. I just got to get in that nook with God. I've got to get in that niche, if you please, with God and figure out what God is trying to do in this season. What is God trying to do in the midst of this struggle? What is God trying to serve me? What's God trying to take out of me? What's God trying to develop in my life? Go and lift your hands right now and say, Lord, show me what you're trying to show me. Teach me what you're trying to teach me. David inquires of the Lord, and the Lord lets him know. So things are going to be different this time. Thou shalt not go up, but fetch a compass behind them and come up upon them over against the mulberry trees. Only God can come up with details like that. Tell you what God is getting ready to do for you in the midst of your struggle. It's going to have fine details in it that when you look back over your shoulder, you're going to know God did that. God orchestrated that. Can no man take the credit for it? Can no man get the accolades for it? God worked out all the details. And he said, you're going to have to listen, baby, because you're going to hear a sound. You're going to hear a sound in the tops of the mulberry trees. And until you hear that sound, you stay put. Don't get too hasty. Don't get too anxious. Just keep trusting God. I want to tell you tonight, don't get anxious in the midst of your struggle and throw in the towel and give up. Oh, I feel like telling some brother here tonight that things are not going the way you want it to go. But I want to tell you, stay the course. Stay the course. Be faithful. Don't quit going to church. Keep your mind made up. And keep listening for the Spirit. Keep listening for the move of the Holy Ghost. Keep listening for the Word of God. There's a sound. There's a sound even now going forth in this room, and the Lord's letting you know it might be hard, it might be difficult, but I've got you right where I need you to be. You're in the midst of the struggle, but there's a blessing that's going to break forth upon you. There's a victory that's going to come as a result of what you are going through. And it came to pass when the king did this. The Bible says that he went forth, he heard the stirring, and he goes out and he smites the host of the Philistines. And did as the Lord had commanded him, and he not only smote them in that victory, but he drives them out all the way unto Gaza. There's some in this room tonight that you are dealing with affliction tonight, maybe sickness, but there's affliction tonight in your life, and you don't understand why you're going through that, and you don't understand why you're suffering through that. But I want to remind you tonight that there is a blessing on the other side of it. Come on, lift your hands right now. Come on, all over this house, all over this house, all over this house. Come on, lift up your voice. You walked in this place tonight, and you've gone through the motions of this church service, but yet in your heart, you're bleeding tonight. You're bleeding tonight. You're hurting, and you don't know what to do, and you're struggling, but God knows where you're at, brother. God knows where you're at, sister. God knows about the sickness. God knows about the affliction tonight. And God's got a blessing in the end of your struggle. I want to open this altar tonight before we all come. I want to open this altar to the stroke. Everybody here don't fit the bill of what I'm talking about tonight. But there's some very specific individuals here tonight that you feel like you are fighting for your very existence. I want you to come right now. I want you to come right now. I told my wife before service, I said, I feel like I'm reaching out for somebody tonight that they don't understand why they're going through what they're going through. They don't understand why they're dealing with what they're dealing with. But God sent you a word tonight to let you know there's purpose in it. And God's got a blessing on the other side of it all. But you got to go through. You got to go through. You got to go through. Come on, lift up your voice, lift up your voice, lift up your voice. Come on, you're going to have to get desperate with the Lord tonight.
Don't curse your struggle, brother. Embrace it tonight.